Okay, I'm back. I'm hoping that the sound is good. If you are online with me, let me know that you can hear me if you're on. I did go back and fix my audio because I had to take off this microphone that I bought. This time it acts like it doesn't want to behave, so I just took it out. I hope you can all hear me. I'm going to be talking about a very, very complex subject because it's inside of our DNA, this particular subject, and it is a genuine cause for debate by many of us who have differing opinions, views about the use of the words. But as is always the case, I am a wordsmith. I am a doctor of words, more or less. I'm a doctor of education, but my forte is racialized words and the evaluation of saying. I want people to know right off the bat that I am not trying to tell you what to do. Okay? That's not my job. I just want you to think. As in everything that I do, I just want you to think, whether you think that I'm not making a damn bit of sense, or you think that I'm making all the sense in the world. I'm opening up this discussion, okay? The title of the essay is not on the website yet. The website is www.calease-writer.com. I'm actually doing this video essay first, and then I will upload it to my website after I'm done. So I put a couple little bells and whistles on it, title and all that kind of stuff, once I get it uploaded to YouTube. The title of this essay is called Coons and Niggers: When Individual and Collective Dignity and Internalized Oppression Compete with Validation. Hold on one second. My grandson is in here with me, and he promised to be quiet. So hold on. Gray, remember you promised to be quiet, right? Okay. That means no noise. I love my grandson. I really do. And trust me, his mind is sharp, and he's listening. Anyway. I always try to make sure that I get an opportunity. Well, let me put it like this. I'm always inspired. I'm always inspired by people and things. And in this particular case, I was inspired by two things. I was inspired by the Black Prop the other day in the Cohen hearings. And I was inspired by one of my dear friends who is always thinking, always thinking. And whether we agree or disagree, she's thinking and she has opinions. And I embrace those opinions and I enjoy reading her comments to the posts that I do. So, without further ado, I want you to take out your dictionaries and your thesauruses and put on your thinking caps and your lenses for this one. Because this is another extremely complex subject. It is one that I am sure everyone will have an opinion, whether it is for the use of these words or not for the use of these words. Again, share this video with your friends. Grab other people and bring them on. It will be on YouTube as well. You can subscribe to my YouTube channel. New. Everything that I do on here, I just upload it to YouTube. Okay. As with every essay that I write on the subject of racism, white supremacy, and evaluating racialized words, my goal is to make you think critically about what it is you are doing, saying, and believing. It is not meant to change your minds. but to ensure that you understand what actually may be motivating some of your unconscious decisions. I was inspired to do this essay by one of my friends and fervent commentators on social media, Tonya Teeter. There are a couple of people who, well, not a couple, there are a number of people who inspire me to write the things that I do. They don't think they inspire me, but they do. And when they do, I will generally put them on here and dedicate an essay to them. So, Tonya was responding to one of the picture posts I put on my Facebook feed about the woman called the Black Prop during the Cohen hearing. In fact, this essay is dedicated to Tonya and her thoughtful and intelligent discussions on the subject. Many of the respondents to the article posts, to the two article posts on this woman, called her Coon, among other names. But Coon stood out as the expressed choice of the Black respondents on both posts. Indeed, the subject of Black people using such words to describe themselves, words created by supremacists for the express purpose of changing the very nature of the Black being from human to animal during the enslavement, is both complicated and polarizing for Black people in the U.S. today. Many people have rationalized these words for everyday language, as either a word of endearment or for use as the best of the worst epithets to describe the worst betrayals of Black people by Black people. Indeed, Black people have embraced and covet these words and constrained their usage to themselves for themselves. A white person dare not utter a stutter of either. In response to my rejection of the use of words such as Coon, Grayson, you leaving? Oh, okay. Anyway, in response to my rejection of the use of words such as Coon, Tonya suggested using the name Sambo instead, referring to the Black antagonist in the fictional story Uncle Tom's Cabin, detailing life during the enslavement. I explained in my response that while the writer of the novel used the name for one of her characters, one must question her motives for using a Black, ethnic, African, racialized name like Sambo for the bad Black in the story, and Tom for the Americanized nice name for the good Negro in the story. I wouldn't comment on whether it is a good or bad substitute for Coon, since like Coon, it was a created name for the character in the book, much like Coon is the characterization of Blacks by whites. And it is a decision for the person deciding to use either, not mine. For certain, the enslaved had their share of Negroes who betrayed other enslaved people for favors from their masters. Perhaps the favor was no beating before bedtime, or an extra piece of fat back, or even perhaps the opportunity to attend worship on Sunday. We can reasonably assume that the Black Prop gets favors. Surely, a favor was an appointment as director of HUD, when clearly, as an event planner for one of Trump's sons, she is not as qualified as some of the career people already working there. We must remember, there are always fundamentally subliminal reasons for the why in the what done by white supremacist influencers in America. Let me repeat that. We must remember there are always fundamentally subliminal reasons why, for the why in the what that is done by white supremacist influencers in America. Now let's talk about dignity. We each have our own individual and personal dignity. We hold on to it with our dear lives. It is precious to us. Each and every person has or should have a personal code of ethics, which is one of the driving forces behind what dignifies us as humans in this life. But because of the degradation and dehumanization of our ancestors throughout our history, we also developed a fragile collective dignity as Black folk. This collective dignity is carved out of the stench of the atrocities of the enslavement, of being coons and niggers, and the inhumanity of racism. Hunted by coon hounds in the South for any attempts at escaping to freedom from slavery, we virtually became like the raccoons or the coons these hounds were named for. In our never-ending resilience, we created our own definition of ourselves using the true reality of our lives with the denunciation of the oppressor's definition of our being, in favor of who we know ourselves to be as a people. No, coons and niggers was a construct, a naming convention designed to dehumanize us and make us animals like raccoons and cattle, and other names like heifer, buck, and pickaninny. No, we refused their definition of us. We were not coons and niggers, not us. We were dignified by our rejection of the definition created for us by white people, and dignified by a new definition we rightly created for ourselves. This collective dignity, believe it or not, is an integral part of our collective Blackness. So when someone betrays that dignity of what is so integral to our own definition and concept of Blackness, why wouldn't we want to immediately distance ourselves from that person? When we are offended by Black people who disrupt the fragility of our collective Blackness, we lash out against that person immediately because our collective dignity has been adversely affected. In terms of the Black prop, we rightly distance ourselves from people like her. We're not like her. We don't even want to be associated with her, right? And I'm not being facetious here. There ain't not one of us complaining about this woman want to be associated with this woman. But I want you to note here that I use the word her. She is an individual, as in just one person. It is important to distinguish the oneness of her, since we need to understand why the behavior of one person seems to affect and reflect on us all. Now, fast forward, backward, not fast forward, but fast backward through history to the enslavement. Once again, let's talk about the enslavement. That thing that some of us do not want to attribute any of the unconscious behavior handed down through generations to us. None of us want to think that anything related to being enslaved has any bearing on us today. During the enslavement, the poor behavior of one slave always, read my lips, always reflected the behavior of them all and affected them all. Whether it was the hobbling of the feet of the runaway slave and the subsequent lockdown of all the others, or all watching unmerciful beatings as an example for similar behavior, rest assured, they were collectively reflected as one, affected as one. This was by design, and the mentality has persisted to this day. The behavior of one person sharing the same skin color as us is still considered a reflection of the entire race. Yeah. Still is. The black prop reflected on all of us up here. Okay? I'm going to talk a little bit about what that is and why that is a little bit later on here. Because, of course, you know, there are other words that are used. Digressed, but okay. Now, take these racialized words, nigger and coon. What possibly better words for black people to use than the vilest representations of our struggle to overcome white supremacy and to distance ourselves from their definition of us? That which we want to believe we have escaped in those particular words. Of course there are others, but those two words are forever etched into the lexicon of U.S. culture and are by far the most popular in the vernacular of racialized words in America, especially used by black people. In much the same way that we created a new definition for ourselves, we tend to rationalize racialized words and attempt, Grayson, I asked you to be quiet. You don't have to leave, you just have to be quiet. But if you want to leave, you can. He's five. Okay. Anyway, I digress. In much the same way that we created a new definition for ourselves, we tend to rationalize words and attempt to make them more palatable in our discourse, if only to desensitize their potential destructive power. This is one of the most terrible and most confoundingly complex parts of what the internalization of oppression has done to the unconscious of some black people in America today. What is internalized oppression? It is the turning inward of that which oppresses us so that we eventually begin to oppress ourselves. This was also by design. Why? Because they created the narrative for us generations ago This is the same narrative we have been struggling to overcome for generations. They know human nature. They have studied it and have it down to a science. To put that literally, these are the words, the phrases, and the definitions they have created. Okay? It is this internalization of oppression which wrestles daily with the fragile collective dignity we share as Black people. And it is what gets lost when these words are used by us to describe us when we are angry with people who share the same skin color as us. Creates a paradox of emotion and confusion because we want to rationalize it. We want to make sense of something that makes no sense on its face. While it is important to understand the language of the oppressor, when we use their language against ourselves, collectively, we are validating and reinforcing their collective ideology, belief, condition, and definition of us. Coons and niggers are reborn again and again, not just as a construct used to negatively define human beings who were placed into bondage generations ago in order to dehumanize them. One second, I have to talk to Grayson. I love my poo. I love him to death. He's gonna be smart, okay? He's gonna know. Cause Nanny gonna make sure that he do. Okay? He ain't gonna be nobody's fool. Anyway. I digress. We are talking about a system and people who thrive on continued mockery. And that mockery is the very reason it felt okay to trot out the Black prop in the first place. It's the same as the college pictures.
Oh, I had no idea. Oh, how insensitive can I be? No, they know exactly what they're doing. Okay?
It's the reason why so many generations ago, the slave masters used people just like her to divide us from our innate collective unity by differentiating who got the chitlins in the garbage and who got the crust of bread on the table in the house. We all know about the house Negroes. We all know about them. We talk about them. But then we turn around and we, well, just like I just did with the word Negro, we give them the other name. We attack our, you know, the collectiveness of Blackness with the other names, which were designed to degrade us and dehumanize us. Therefore, like it or not, whether she is eating from the table or the garbage, she is still considered Black by white people as long as white supremacy as an ideology exists, and they are banking on our shared belief that the behavior of one of us reflects on all of us, and we can be assured that when we call her those names that they created, we are virtually legitimizing the very existence of Coons. And that is no matter how we try to rationalize it and make these words more palatable to ourselves. Understanding that validating these words is even more damaging to us than the individual behavior of an individual person, even if that person shares our skin color, is going to be a challenging exercise among Black people as we move into the future of an individualized world. A world which is still foreign to Black people, even as we have been living in it for the past two generations among individualized white people. But that's another essay for another time. The important thing to ask yourself is this: does what she did mean that you share any shame? Should you be blamed for what she did? Does her behavior affect your personal, individual dignity? Is she you? If the answer to any of these questions is no, then realize you do not need to validate your individual dignity or our collective dignity because of the misbehavior of an individual who shares our color. Am I telling you to stop using the words? No. Do I hope my essay will affect how you think about these racialized words going forward? I hope so. But as always, my number one goal is to make you think closely and consider critically what much of what we take for granted in terms of how we think and the racialized words we use. I'm not trying to change your mind, but I'm trying to open them. Here's to open minds. That's it. That's the end of the essay. Thank you, Tonya, I'm not sure quite how to pronounce it, but thank you so very much for your thoughtful comments. I really appreciate the comments that I get from people, as long as they are given with the respect and individual dignity in of the person they are commenting to and reciprocated. And that's the way it's supposed to be. Because not everybody is going to agree with everything that I write. And not everybody is going to agree. Not everybody's going to agree with the comments made by the people. But if the discussions that come about enlighten some people, open up some minds, make you think, then it's all worth it. Then it's all worth it. Now, let me look and see. It looks here that I've got a couple of people. Got some people who are watching. Okay. Yeah. I'm glad some of you are watching. I wish that you, I hope that you'll share some of the things that I write. On my formal page, the like page, I'll have this up there too. And I more than likely will have the essay as a written note. If you go to notes, you'll see some of the essays that I've done. Not all of them. My website has all of them. But some of the featured ones I will put on their Facebook page. So if I don't have any questions, let me see. Do I have any questions? Thank you. I will be responding. Susie, hi. Diane, hi. Michael, hi. Walter. Leonard. Capone Lopez, Eric Harp, Lewis Kelly, Dan Hettemansberger, Dan, Linda, hey Linda,
that's my sister,
no wait, no that's my niece, let me stop, that's my niece-in-law. Okay, Tamika Rice, Brian Parr, Mark Williams, Kevin Dixon, Tanya, thank you, my dear, for inspiring me. Thank you so much. I really appreciate you more than you will probably ever know, because I read everything that you comment on, and like I said, even when we don't agree, there are pieces, and there are bits and pieces that we can find common ground on some of these subjects, and I respect you very, very much, and I thank you. Gail Brown, Chris Smith, Arthur Taylor, Phoenix Woods, Shaibu, Ali Mohammed, Andra Wellesley, Sandra Broadus. I love your name. I love your name. I love you, the last name Broadus. I love that. I love that. Okay, and the volume is low. It's actually very high on my, it's at the highest level on my computer, so I can't control that part of it any lower, and it would just not, I can't, you know, that's the high, it's at the highest point at this point. I'm going to hopefully, I bought a mic. Hopefully I'll be able to get it to work properly at some point in the not too distant future. Janet, Vincent, Brian. There are a number of people. I hope I'm not missing anybody. Michael Washington and Josh Olinger. Hi, how are you? Yeah, anyway, I was hoping to get a few questions, but I was hoping. Oh, Diane, you're saying, as a white person, do you have the right to tell black kids not to use racial slurs in your presence? No. No, you do not. And it's not even a matter of do you have the right, because it has nothing to do with your right to do anything. It's just not appropriate for you to involve yourself in a conversation that they are having, because in their minds they are not using racial slurs, because they don't see them that way. In their families, those words have been rationalized to make them more palatable. Okay, so if you're gonna end up looking like exception of grabbing the phone and calling the police, you would be considered someone like the people who get involved in things that are going on with black people that are none of their business, okay? And that would be none of your business to interject yourself into, okay? Yeah. Anyway, are there any questions that concern the use of black people using, and this deals with black people using these terms with black people, about black people, for black people. Okay, this doesn't have anything to do with white people and their use of the words toward us. That's a whole nother subject. Okay, we're talking about when black people, in their attempt to differentiate themselves and distance themselves from those other black people who they consider have betrayed blackness as a state of being,
okay? Those are the people who are the subjects of this discussion, okay? And the terms that they use, whether knowingly or unknowingly, using the same words that were designed by the oppressors to dehumanize us. What makes it okay now in the 21st century to use the same words against ourselves that were used against us? That's the focus of my discussion. Tanya has some great points on it. Great points. But even with those points, I argue that they are still rationalizations of these words to try to make them seem okay to use. They're okay to use if you put them on something else, as far as I'm concerned, but they don't apply. You wouldn't call a white person, although I've heard people do it. It makes no sense. I've heard white people call that N-word. But it makes no sense. It absolutely makes no sense. Because that word wasn't designed for them. It has no effect. The effect, whether we want it to or not, reflects on all of us as a collective. Hey, Chris. Hey, Greta. That's my girl. Crystal Clado. That's my girl. Yep, so anyway, if there are no questions, I will be checking this out once I upload this video to to my Facebook pages. Hi, Beverly. Once I upload this video, then I will go back to it into the comment section, and I'll try to respond to as many comments as I can. Hey, Chris. I really appreciate you. But yeah, so anyway, I'm going to go. And, oh, hi, Delilah. Oh, yeah. No problem. Like I said, share this video with people that you think might be interested in it, who might have something to say about it, you know. Anybody who feels strongly about it and has an opinion about it, give it to them. Let them see it. Invite them to my website. There's a link to my website on my formal page. That one is C.Elise Smith. If you get on Facebook and put that name in, C.Elease Smith, you'll get to my formal page. That's that like page. And feel free to share that too. And invite people to like that page. Hey, Khalil, how you doing? How are you? Oh, thank you, darling. Thank you, Crystal. Yes, I got it done on Saturday. On selfie. It has become Selfie Saturday, okay? That's what it is. It used to be Hair Day. My husband used to call it Beautiful Saturday. That's what Ray used to call it. It's Beautiful Saturday, because that's the day that I got my hair done. But now it's Selfie Saturday, because it's the one day every 2 weeks that I get to express my inner narcissist. And my husband gives me the side eye. Because I'm like, oh, I don't care what those guys say. I don't care what people say. I do admit that I am flattered. Because I'm old as dirt. I'm 65 years old. Okay, December 27, 1953. So,
something heavy, okay? Animal. So it's nice. It's nice that people say nice things. Cause listen, I get my share of bad stuff too. I haven't gotten a death threat yet, and I ain't trying to encourage one. But I have been told I'm a bit radical, but I'm not. I'm just truthful, and I'm just honest, and I'm just educated, and I have a mission. That's what it is. Oh, Delilah, you're older than me by 2 months. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. She says that we couldn't live without that dirt. I know that's right. I know that's right. Well, listen, I've been on here. I've actually taken away from the importance of, oh, thank you. Oh, Diane. Yeah. Well, wait, you had me cracking up talking about I make you nervous. That had me cracking up. I was listening to Diane. But anyway, this is a serious subject. It is a very complex subject for Black people. It's something that we wrestle with all the time. Like, when is it not okay to use words that were designed to dehumanize us? When is it okay? When is it not okay? If we change a letter here and there, we call ourselves, instead of, if we use the A instead of the ER, does that make it better? You know? I, for one, am not a raccoon. So, you know. Anyway. Oh, hi, Bella. Bella Foley. True to the words. Yeah, you know that's right. That's the thing. I was telling Crystal this morning. She was at my house this morning. She is a premier massage therapist. And I was talking to her about my intention of writing this essay today and of doing the video essay for it today. And we were talking, and you know, she's the one who said, you know, some people think that you're radical, and I say, no she's not. No, you know what's anytime someone is talking about those things that are spooky, scary, not that are kind of frightening to some people and that are unnerving to others, then yeah, I guess you might call me a radical. But then ever since I was called that N-word the very first time in my life, I became radical. So you could say I've been radical since I was about 7, maybe 8 years old, I think. Yeah, I've been radical ever since then. Mm-hmm. Yes, I have. And my kids will tell you how radical I am. I'm radical. I guess you could say I am. And I am, as you say, Crystal, true to the words. Because I am a wordsmith. I will bust a word down to its root, prefix, and suffix, if necessary, to make a point and to explain. Just so you know. You know, just so you know what the word is about that you're using. You know, if we were talking and we were speaking in another language, I'd be doing the same thing to those words. But we speak American. And there are words within this American language that are racialized or have been racialized. You know, some are by their very usage, such as nigger and coon, you know. Then there are others, such as like minority, which have been racialized. They didn't start out that way, but when they were made to be associated with a person's state of being by adding the ity to the word minor. Well, I talked about that on another essay. I don't know whether you guys saw that one, but I also have it written, I believe. Do I have it written? No, I didn't. That's actually a presentation that I did visually. I didn't write that as an essay. So that's only in video form. Just in case you go to my website, click on videos, and you'll see all of the videos if you don't want to go to YouTube. You have a hard time finding me there. I'm not a star of YouTube, so it might take a little bit to find me there. But anyway, Ken, I'm so proud of you and Char and your kids. I knew Ken and Char when they were a young couple. Oh God, it's gonna make me cry. Ah, and Snowy the dog, that big ass dog that used to go in the yard. Every time I go to walk into the yard, he come boop, 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 boop. And he used to bark like this, boof, boof. Scared, always scared the bejesus out of me. But I loved the two of them. They represented so much of the hope and joy of life and the expectations of family. And these two people have raised four children. One is graduating from college, one is going into college, and the other two in a couple of years are bound for college. One is going to be a doctor, one's going to be a lawyer. You know, it's like, anyway, I just keep digressing, but I'm so happy to see that you tuned in there, Ken. I'm so happy that you did. Yeah. Oh, thank you, Chris. Yeah, that was the hope. That was the hope. I was hoping that I would be able to, I was hoping that I would be able to break it down in such a way that people would understand. Not that I'm expecting anybody to stop calling a black person that name, or, you know, the other one, or, you know, I don't have expectations of change very quickly, because it took a very, very long time for us to get to where we are today in the 21st century, both in the sense of our struggle to overcome and in terms of the damage, which is now just a part of our DNA from generations and generations of internalized oppression. So, you know, just kind of putting those two things together to make, you know, to help people to understand why these rationalizations are even possible. You know, why we can, because we want to try to make, look, we took their definition, basically, we took their definition of black and darkness and the evil, and we turned that mess around. So much so that when James Brown came out with "Say It Loud, I'm Black and I'm Proud," that was all part of that. That was all part of that flipping of the script during that time to say, okay, we see what has been done. We're going to flip the script around to tell the truth about what it means for us. And that's what we've been doing ever since. Now we can get a handle on these words that have become so commonplace with us that we've rationalized their use. Now once we start realizing what that is all about, maybe we will stop using them and realize that it really doesn't help matters when we use their words against ourselves. You know? Anyway, I'm gonna go. If that is it. Oh, see, every time I say I'm gonna get off this thing, I end up, go ahead, I know you want to, come on, I know you do, Grayson, and there's Pat, hey, we share the same birthday, that's my baby, hey, Pat, hey, I miss you. I mean, how long has it been since we've actually been in each other's physical presence? How many years? 20? At least? That's why I say thank God for Facebook, because I wouldn't get to see or communicate with half the people that I do had it not been for Facebook. I got reconnected to so many friends and family through Facebook. And I get to slide over there onto Pate's page every now and then, just to see how she's doing. So it's good to see you here. It's good to see you on. I don't know at what point you came in, but the essay that I did will be in my notes section of my formal page. That is on Facebook, C.ALEASE Smith, the like page. It'll be on there, and it will also be on my website, www.calease-writer.com, and Elise is spelled A-L-E-A-S-E. I'm named after my grandmother. It's also my pen name for when I write books, C.Elise. It's given honor to my nanny. And let's see, if there are no questions, which there aren't, I am going to finally bid everybody a fond farewell, and keep your minds open, your lenses on, and your thinking cap on. Talk to you later. Bye-bye.